Hello friends, I, Utkarsh Mathur, take the privilege to welcome you all to the webinar with Dr. Girish, Ahuja and CA Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Singhal. Dr. Girish, Ahuja, widely known as the tax guru of the nation, is here with us today for the discussion on current tax issues. He has addressed over 3,000 seminars and co-authored 26 books. He is currently the chairman of the audit committee of the SBI and independent director at Varun Beverages and Amber Enterprises. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you.
We also have with us CA Sanjeev Kumar Singhal. He is an FCA with 20 years of experience. He is a BCom honors graduate from Sriram College of Commerce. He was the university topper. He has done his PhD in international finance from Faculty of Management Studies. And he was a management trainee at SEDBI, vice president at Cyber Media, Religare and Jubilant Life Sciences. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, you are currently on the committee, you are a committee member which is rewriting the Income Tax Act. What is the approach being followed?
The direction from the government is they try to simplify this law. Of course, all exemption deductions which we are having these days may go. They want the law should be so simple that everybody should be able to understand. And we should also look into the internet, best international practices while bringing this law into. And we are trying to do away with, you know, provisions, provisos or explanations as far as possible is concerned. And of course, that very difficult thing, notwithstanding anything contained, all these things we will try to remove. And we'll try to make it so simple that an ordinary man can also understand. But you know that revenue laws cannot be that simple. It cannot be those simple. But yes, for an ordinary man, for ordinary provisions, they will remain simple. But for corporate taxation, for international taxation, how can you make them simple? So it will be a combination of simplicity, of course, but at the same time, not that complication for international taxation as well as for corporate. We'll see to it that due importance is given to the salaried class so that they may not be victimized. And the other things the government has given us direction. So we are on the right path. Let's see what can we do in that.
So it's a good news that we'll have a simplified tax, Income Tax Act. Sir, what is the general level of tax compliance you see in our country?
Well, I would say the compliance is not that big, you know. What I'm trying to explain in this is that we have about 1 crore 70 lakh people filing a return of income, but they don't pay any tax. The total number of returns last year was 8 crores. Out of 8 crore, you can imagine 1 crore 60 lakh are not paying, or approximately not paying any tax. But out of a population of 130 crores, if only 8 crore people are filing return, very few people are there who are filing return about 10 lakhs. Very few people are there. Maybe you can count them in lakhs, not even in crores. So that is why the government is very serious these days. They want that honest taxpayer should not be penalized. But of course, if a person is dishonest and trying to do any hanky-panky things, he's going to have a very tough time, let me tell you, for the time to come. So I'm also all the time saying people, pay tax and enjoy your life. Pay tax and enjoy your life. The maximum rate is 30%. Quite possible they may reduce that rate once they think that there is a big compliance. These days, of course, there is a compliance about TDS. And people are feeling very happy about the TDS part in the sense that you now you have 26 years coming out from that after filing the return. And that 26 helps us to file our return of income as far as possible in a right manner.
Honesty being the best policy always. So, Sanjeev sir, we would like your brief overview of on ICDS, that is the Income Computation and Disclosure Standard. Yeah.
So, Utkarsh, ICDS were introduced by the government for the first time for the previous year 15-16, that is the assessment year 16-17. In fact, this government, when it came to the power, so while presenting the union budget, the Honorable Finance Minister Arun Jaitley mentioned that India will have ICDS, and they were also brought in view of the introduction of the Ind AS, so that the interest of the revenue can be taken care of. However, on the demand of the industry, ICDS were deferred for 1 year, that is from previous year 15-16, they were deferred to previous year 16-17, that is assessment year 17-18. However, there was a case in a judgment given by the Delhi High Court in Union of India versus Chamber of Tax Consultants. The High Court objected to certain provisions of the ICDS which were conflicting with the judicial pronouncements. So in a way, High Court quashed most of the provisions of ICDS. However, while presenting the budget 2018, the finance minister reiterated the need for the same and inserted the relevant provisions in the finance bill 2018. With the enactment of the finance bill 2018, in the form of a finance act 2018, those issues which were objected to by the Delhi High Court, they become part of the law, and hence ICDS are applicable as originally envisaged from the previous year 16-17 or the assessment year 17-18. It needs to be noted that ICDS apply while computing the taxable income under two heads. So as you know that there are five heads of income: salary, business profession, capital gains, house property, and income from other sources. So ICDS are applicable while computing income under the head profits and gains from business or profession and income from other sources. And they apply only when an SSC is following the accrual basis of accounting. So if an SSC is following the cash basis of accounting, then certainly the ICDS will not be applicable.
Continuing with the discussion on
ICDS. I just wanted to ask one thing, Sanjeev, what is your opinion about this ICDS? Should they be there in the new income tax act which we are redrafting, or should it not be there?
Sir, in my view, ICDS was not required. We already have the accounting standards, we have the income tax act. So it's my humble request that if the government can actually consider it, and since you are a part of the committee, I would humbly request that the ICDS be done away with in the new income tax act.
That's very good. Let's hope for that. We will of course recommend that, but it's up to the government to accept or not to accept that. But I'm also of the view that these ICDS are not more required.
There are 10 ICDS, so let me briefly talk about first 5 ICDS and then we can take up the next question. So the first ICDS deals with the disclosure of accounting policies. The relevant accounting standard for this is AS1, which is on accounting policies. What we need to keep in mind, when an SSC is starting from his profit as per the accounting standard, that is from financial statement, what adjustment he may be required to make. The first and the most fundamental difference in ICDS 1 and AS 1 is on account of the concept of materiality. While preparing the financial statement and while doing the audit, materiality is the most fundamental aspect which is kept in mind. So if an item is immaterial, now what is materiality? That differs from organization to organization, depending on its revenue, depending on its profit. But say for example, if an item was considered immaterial in financial statement and it was ignored, for the purpose of computing the taxable income, this will have to be brought back to the textbooks. So say for example, a calculator is purchased with a useful life of more than 1 year, and calculator is for 1,000 rupees, and company has a policy of expensing any item purchased up to 5,000 rupees. So in their profit and loss account, they would have charged it to P&L. However, for the purpose of income tax, if I strictly go by the rules, this will need to be added to the block of assets and depreciation will need to be charged. So an auditor as well as the management should also look at the items which they might have ignored on account of being immaterial in financial statement, and for the purpose of computing taxable income, they should add them back and then compute the taxable income accordingly. The second difference, which is an ICDS.
Sir, how difficult will it be for an auditor to look into all these minor details?
Absolutely, sir. So this is one more reason that why we requested that ICDS should be dispensed with in the next edition of the Income Tax Act. This is very, very difficult and no useful purpose is going to be served by this. And the next, sir, if you really see while we started our commerce education I started in class 11. Some people might have started at graduation level. We have been told principle of conservatism, principle of prudence, that is, provide for all anticipated losses, but do not recognize anticipated gains. However, prudence has no scope in ICDS. So if there is a reasonable certainty for an expense to be incurred, it is allowed as an expense. Similarly, if there is a reasonable certainty for a gain to be received by a company, you have to offer tax.
Meaning thereby, those that prudence principle, which I also learned, anticipate all losses, right, but do not take into consideration any income unless it is realized. It is the other way around.
Yes.
It appears to be prepone all incomes, whether realized or not, and postpone all losses or expenses unless they are actually incurred.
Absolutely.
Surprised,
yes, sir.
What kind of a principle is there? We were anticipating every all losses which we could think of in your account, but this is only for income tax point of view.
This is only for income tax purposes.
Accountancy remains the same,
but sir, at the end of the day, it is tax which matters. It is a saying that there are only two things certain in life: tax and death. So it is tax and account. Rest all is general entry. Tax is cash outflow. Moving on to ICDS-2 on inventories, there is a very important concept. It is debated that what should be done with VAT, service tax or GST. While for the purpose of accounting, the principle is simple. Say if I have to present my financial statements for 2017-18, how I'll present revenue from operation gross, less excise duty, since excise duty was there for 3 months, April, May, June, and in some cases, excise duty is still there. Say for example, petroleum products. So I'll say less excise duty, and then I'll get revenue from operations net. Now this is how I present in the financial statement. I do not add any VAT, service tax or GST. However, for the purpose of valuation of inventory, now because of section 145A and also because of ICDS 2, I'll have to add whether it is VAT or it is service tax or GST to the valuation of inventory, both in opening stock as well as in closing stock.
If I am not mistaken, this was there earlier also.
Yes, sir.
And Institute had given some guidance at that particular,
yes,
point of time that it doesn't make any difference.
Right.
Will it make a difference in this case?
Sir, in my view, it will make a difference in this case. Say, for example, there is an item which is appearing in the closing stock and it has not been sold, and hence GST not deposited till the due date of furnishing the return of income, then under section 43B, it will not be allowed as an expense. And what happens over a long run, it will be...
Long run,
it will neutralize.
But year-wise, year, there will,
yes,
be a problem.
Yes,
okay.
It's a question of, you know, year-by-year taxation. And hence, this will have an
impact. This is done, you know. But whatever, maybe, yes, the law is law. I can't criticize the law.
Now we'll also discuss briefly about ICDS 3 on construction contract and ICDS 4, which is on revenue. Construction contract, the very important point is that in case of construction contract, if a contract has progressed to the stage of 25% or more, then even if you have not recognized income in the financial statement, you'll have to recognize the income under taxation. Take a situation, if a company is under Ind AS.
Percentage of completion.
Yes. If a company is under Ind AS, they are a real estate developer, and under Ind AS 115, more often than not, they will end up using a completed contract method. Say for example, a company has a project of 500 crore rupees with a expected profit of 100 crore rupees, and it will be completed in 4 years. 125 crore rupees of revenue and 25 crore rupees of profit will accrue under ICDS 3. So first 3 year you pay normal tax on 25 crore rupees. I'm assuming same proportion of work gets completed.
But that accounting to me, even now these days also, they were not increasing completed.
Yes.
Even in income tax. Those who were following completed method for ages, they were being allowed. But a new project you take up, a new SSC who comes up, they were not allowing the completed project.
So they were not doing, absolutely right. But in the financial statement also, percentage completion method was being followed. So there was no mismatch,
okay,
which was increased. Okay. Now, if you follow completed contract method, there's going to be a complete mismatch. First 3 years, you have no revenue, you have no profit, your EPS is nil or maybe negative.
Oh.
Fourth year, you recognize entire profit and pay MAT. So it's a dual taxation. You get met benefit, but that will be over a period of time. So this is going to be a double whammy for the companies.
Hardship.
Yes. And then the next important point in this is retention money is to be included in the taxable income. In accountancy, we will see whether what is the realizability, etc. But under ICDS 3, this will have to be included in income.
Meaning thereby, if the retention money is taken into consideration today and tomorrow the person has to incur any expenditure, that will be allowed next year.
In future, I believe it should be allowed. But as you said, sir, prepone all income and postpone
retention
all expenses.
Retention money is prepone.
Yes. Right. Another very interesting concept is if you have, say for example, borrowed money for this construction contract. So I was explaining that if there are some borrowed funds and there's a temporary income which is received, I mean there is an income which is received from temporary investment. Say for 1 month this money was invested in an FD. Now under accountancy, in financial statement, this interest income will be reduced from interest expense. Whereas in income tax, they say first you pay tax on this. So this is treated as income and the full interest will be allowed as an interest expense and may have to be capitalized if the certain conditions are satisfied. So again, this will lead to preponement of income because this FD income is to be offered for tax in the year in which it is accrued itself. Then under ICDS 4 on revenue, there is one important point.
But there is the judgment of Bokaro Steel and there is another judgment I remember where it is pre-incorporation or whatever it may be. Or maybe if the asset is not installed prior basis, you could deduct the amount of interest from the construction cost, provided it has been given for the purpose of an advance given to the contractor to do that. And if they have been charging interest on that is allowed. But of course, this is surplus fund, which of course will be taken.
Right. In ICDS 4, there is one important point that needs to be considered. Earlier, for the services contracts, under AS 9, you could apply a completed contract. But now under ICDS 4, unless a contract is only up to 90 days, one has to apply percentage completion.
What is the concept of this 90 days?
90 days, it's a short, say for example, there is a chartered accountancy firm. Sir, both of us are chartered accountants and of course PhDs. Suppose they get an internal audit for 6 months. The fees is 1,80,000 and they are following accrual basis of accounting, falling into the ICDS. Now they'll have to recognize income and they'll have to pay tax on percentage completion basis.
I think it is state line method.
Yes, this is state
line. The service is state.
Yes, this is state line.
I mean, 6 months you can allocate it.
Yes.
Yeah.
So suppose they get this contract on 1st of January and this internal audit will be completed by 30th of June. So, for the
that is more than 90 days.
Yes, more than 90 days. So, you have to apply percentage completion method.
But meaning thereby, in the case of 90 days, suppose I get a contract on 1st of March, it will fall into two financial years. So, in that case, I may not take it.
Yes, in that case.
Because first 1 month, yes. I may not take it. Because total is 90 days, the entire 90 days will complete. I can take it in the next 2 months, you know, the means May month.
Yes.
The 90 days. That is the reason of 90 days.
Yes.
Because in the same year, 90 days will be 365 days. So there is no meaning.
Right.
The meaning is only when those 90 days fall in two financial years. One X financial by the next financial year. In that case, of course, I am not. Correct?
Yeah.
This is what I mean.
Yes. Now in ICDS 5, which is on tangible fixed asset, two important points needs to be noted. First of all, in financial statement, we have a concept of charging depreciation on each asset. And now under Schedule 2 to the Companies Act 2013, read with Accounting Standard 10, there is a concept of component accounting. Say for example, if there is an aircraft, it can have three components, an engine, interiors and the frame. So each will have to be depreciated separately. But in income tax, there is no such concept. There is a concept of block of assets. To the earlier practice under Section 30.
Component cost, you are saying, that component is accountancy, not an income.
Yes, not income.
The component is how much percentage?
As such, there is no such specific guideline. However, according to guidance issued by an institute, if up to 10%, if the component value is up to 10% of the value of the asset, you can ignore that component from being recognized as a separate component.
In the accountancy. In income tax, it doesn't make any difference.
Yes. Now, Another important aspect that needs to be considered is that under accounting standard 10, the decommissioning cost or the asset retirement obligation, say for example, if someone takes an office on lease rent, makes some leasehold improvements, and the agreement says that after the lease period, say of 9 years is over, you have to dismantle all these. Say the dismantling cost is 50 lakh rupees. One has to provide for it in the beginning at the present value. So one will compute the present value of this 50 lakh, which means I'll discount it for 9 years. Suppose the value comes 30 lakh rupees. I will capitalize this 30 lakh rupees and make a provision for the asset retirement obligation of
in accountants.
In accountants.
Not in income tax.
Not in income tax. So I will charge depreciation on it. And every year I will true up this 30 lakhs so that in 9 years it becomes 50 lakh. And this 30 lakh to 32 lakh, 32 to 34.5, etc., year by year difference will go to the P&L of
the
finance.
It affects the income part.
Now, sir, it will affect
income tax under income tax.
We are saying the adjustments that you have to make for the purpose of reporting in your Form 3CD. In financial statement, you would have capitalized and provided for this expense.
Correct.
But in income tax, this will have to be ignored.
Oh, I see.
So to make an Excel sheet or
maybe the other, now this is the different method of doing it.
Yes.
Okay, that point is irrelevant. Okay. That means you are trying to say that in accountancy we have done a different thing, but for the purpose of income tax, that point is not valid because accountants, you are preparing the account for that. Maybe for book profit it is valid, but for this income tax it is not.
Yes, it is not.
So, because we have a concept of 180 days or something and nothing else.
No. So that is there in income tax, but there is not such a concept in financial statements. So, Utkarsh, these are the...
My point is, this is a question which I have come to. Just somebody asked me also. Suppose I have taken a land on lease, say 30 years, 40 years, 50 years, and I construct a building on that. I have already constructed. I am charging the depreciation. Suddenly what happens is the lease is over. And he wants the land back. The building is already there. So that means I will have to provide for that building cost to be dismantled if he doesn't want to take the building.
Absolutely. You'll have to.
You have to provide for it.
Yes, you have to provide.
What will be the cost of dismantling that building? But at the same time, I'll be getting some revenue from there also from the sale of scrap. That has to be net up.
Yes. Okay. So ICDS 6 deals with the effect of change in the exchange rate. Corresponding standard is accounting standard 11. So accounting standard 11 talks about monetary and non-monetary item. Similar thing is there in ICDS 6. A monetary item is an item which is receivable or payable in a fixed or determinable amount of money. For example, trade receivables, trade payables. Fixed assets and inventory, they are not monetary items. They are non-monetary items. So the standard talks about translation of the same. Translation of the monetary item at the exchange rate prevailing on the balance sheet date. So that is allowed, there is no difference between that. However, accounting standard 11 deals with only the forward exchange contract, that their mark to market can be taken to profit and loss account. ICDS 6 includes some more instruments into the forward exchange contract.
I want to say, there is one 43A section.
Yes.
Oh, that talks about the foreign exchange fluctuations. So if you have borrowed money from foreign country or you have acquired asset on credit from foreign.
Right.
So there is another section, I think 43AA something has been.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Right. So that section will prevail. That section will.
43 will remain.
Yes.
But it is in relation to that 43AA has been.
Yes.
Okay.
So that's been introduced. So mark to market losses will be allowed only if they are allowed under ICDS 6. Whereas if you are following accounting standards, then there is a guidance note on derivative which allows all mark to market losses. And if you are following Ind AS, then of course in the derivative, falling under Ind AS 109, that mark to market losses are to be taken to profit and loss account unless you have taken a hedge and you are doing the hedge accounting, whether it's a cash flow hedge accounting or it's a fair value hedge accounting. ICDS 7 is on government grant.
I heard that there are two types of mark to market.
So this is a finer point. Actually, mark to market, generally people consider there is only one mark to market. Mark to market technically can be two types, a dirty mark to market and a clean mark to market. A dirty mark to market includes the interest element into it. Consider a situation, a company has taken a bank loan on 1st of February and the first repayment date is 30th of April. Now the mark to market which will be there on 31st March, banker generally will include 2 months interest in that mark to market. It is in the interest of the SSC to segregate the same, because mark to market treatment is different and interest is going to be allowed.
We will also provide, I think, when I work out a system of accounting, even if it is due after 3 months or four months or 6 months, or 31st March, we will provide for it.
Sir, SSC will provide. SSC will provide. But if he doesn't know that this mark to market includes the interest component, he may provide again the entire mark to market.
Okay, then you may not provide separately. But yeah. Because you already provide.
Yes. So, I mean, few people are not aware of this dirty mark to market concept, and a clean mark to market is pure mark to market which does not include the interest element. Moving on to ICDS 7 on government grant, it's very interesting. Under AS 12 or IND AS 20, which deals with government grant is to be recognized when there is a reasonable assurance that the company will comply with the condition attached and the grant will be received. However, as Girish Ahuja sir said in the beginning, ICDS aims for prepone all income, postpone all expenses. So the concept applies here also. It says the government grant is to be recognized as an income under ICDS 7 when there is a reasonable assurance that you will comply with the condition, or when the grant has been received, whichever is earlier. So if you receive the grant today and you comply with the condition next year, you in the first year pay normal tax, in the next year you take it to accounting income and pay MAT based on book.
But one thing, normally you don't get a grant from government advance.
Normally you don't. Rather, you take years together to get the money. But if they get it, then that should be. ICDS.
But one more thing,
yes, sir.
मुझे सब कुछ पता है, लेकिन मैं भी आपका टेस्ट करना चाहता हूँ.
बिल्कुल आपका स्टूडेंट.
What I'm trying to say, we have an explanation 10 under section 43(1), which says that if you receive a grant for a capital asset, it should be deducted from there to calculate depreciation.
Right.
To calculate depreciation. Right. तो वो तो वही रहेगा ना.
वो वही रहेगा. Interestingly, sir, Ind AS में वो अब allowed नहीं है. Ind AS में आप asset को gross value पे दिखाएंगे और grant को deferred income में लेके जाएंगे. ICDS में उल्टा करेंगे. तो आपको जो अकाउंट्स में क्या
हम इतना सपना हो आईसीडी हमें इंसिडेंस नहीं आता हमारा लेवल कर
सर हम ये
बड़ा लेवल ना दिखा
हम ये बता रहे हैं फाइनेंशियल स्टेटमेंट से आईसीडीएस पे कैसे पहुंचना
है. ओके 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 ठीक है.
कमिंग ऑन टू आईसी
बड़ी कंपनी से हम छोटे कंपनी वाले
हम हमेशा आपके स्टूडेंट रहे.
चलो चलो
स्टूडेंट रहे.
ओके ओके.
आईसीडीएस 8 डील्स विद द सिक्योरिटीज. एक सिंपल कांसेप्ट में समझाता हूं. अकाउंटेंसी में फाइनेंशियल स्टेटमेंट में हम आइटम वाई आइटम लोअर ऑफ कॉस्ट और मार्केट वैल्यू ले सकते हैं, बट यहाँ ICDS 8 ने कहा आप चार बास्केट बना दीजिए अपनी सारी इन्वेस्टमेंट को. बास्केट 1, बास्केट 2, बास्केट 3,
पहली बकेट.
हाँ, बकेट में डिवाइड करिए. कैसे? पहली बकेट में सारे शेयर डाल दीजिए, दूसरी बकेट में सारी डेट सिक्योरिटीज, तीसरी में सारी कन्वर्टेबल इंस्ट्रूमेंट लाइक कन्वर्टेबल डिबेंचर, कन्वर्टेबल प्रेफरेंशियल, फोर्थ में एनी अदर सिक्योरिटी. बकेट 1 उठाइए, उसमें 10 शेयर है, हर एक की सपोज कॉस्ट 10-10 रुपए है, किसी की वैल्यू मार्केट वैल्यू 9, किसी की 11, किसी की 15, किसी की 4, सबको टोटल कीजिए.
अच्छा, अलग अलग नहीं,
अलग अलग नहीं ले सकते. तो कॉस्ट आई 100 और मार्केट वैल्यू आई 90, तो आप 90 लोअर ऑफ कॉस्ट और मार्केट वैल्यू लेंगे, चाहे आप इंडिविजुअली
बुक. अर्लियर वी यूज्ड टू टेक आइटम बाय
आइटम बाय ऐसे. फिर बकेट 2 उठाएंगे, बकेट 3 उठाएंगे, बकेट 4. इसमें भी आपका अकाउंटिंग और टैक्स मिसमैच आएगा, बट ओवर अ पीरियड ऑफ टाइम
आपका सब न्यूट्रलाइज हो जाएगा.
ऑब्वियस वो न्यूट्रलाइज.
ऑब्वियस.
अब आता हूं आईसीडीएस
पर. ये तभी आएगा जब लॉस का इसमें लॉस किसी अगर तो सारे ऊपर है
तो ठीक है उसके.
आजकल तो स्टॉक मार्केट ऊपर है
आजकल मार्केट, लेकिन सर मिड कैप और स्मॉल कैप नहीं चाहिए.
ओके.
मैंने तो पीएचडी स्टॉक मार्केट में की, मैं पैसे नहीं लगाता स्टॉक मार्केट में.
अरे ये मत कहो यार, मैंने लगाया. चलिए ओके.
आईसीडीएस 9 है बोरिंग कॉस्ट पे. इसमें 5 इंपॉर्टेंट डिफरेंसेस, 5-6. एक तो इन्वेंटरी अगर है व्हिच टेक्स 12 मंथ्स और मोर टू गेट रेडी फॉर इट्स इंटेंडेड यूज, तो उसकी फंडिंग के लिए अगर आपने पैसे बोरो किया है तो वो इंटरेस्ट आप इन्वेंटरी में ऐड करेंगे. हम बोलते हैं इन्वेंटरी में कैपिटलाइज करेंगे, इन्वेंटरी में ऐड करेंगे. फॉर एग्जांपल आता है 2 साल एज
किया हुआ, ऊपर वाला,
हां 1 साल से 2 साल एज किया हुआ राइस. मैं कंपनी का नाम नहीं लूंगा, अलग अलग कंपनियों के आते हैं, पर इस केस
पतंजलि का नाम
पतंजलि का ले सकते हैं. बिल्कुल ले
सकते.
तो उस केस में आप उसकी इन्वेंटरी की वैल्यू में ऐड करेंगे उस इंटरेस्ट को. दूसरा, accounting standard 16 जो borrowing cost है
ये तो बिल ये तो उसमें भी होता है इसकी अगर आप
accounting standard होता है लेकिन हाँ यस उसमें भी होता है
12 साल पढ़ा लेकिन मैं पीता नहीं हूँ लेकिन मुझे idea है चलिए सर
फिर accounting standard 16 में एक substantial period of time का concept है यानी कि प्रॉपर्टी प्लांट इक्विपमेंट या कोई और एसेट के लिए 12 महीने या उससे ज्यादा होंगे जनरली तब आप इंटरेस्ट कैपिटलाइज कर सकते हैं बट इनकम टैक्स तो सब कुछ कैपिटलाइज करना चाहता है ताकि आपको रेवेन्यू एक्सपेंडिचर ना देना पड़े तो अगर 3 महीने में भी आपने उस एसेट को इंस्टॉल्ड और पुट टू यूज कर दिया तब भी आप उसका इंटरेस्ट कैपिटलाइज कर
36(1)(3) में लिखा ही हुआ है टिल द एसेट इज पुट टू राइट
लेकिन सब्सटेंशियल अकाउंटेंसी में 12 या 12 महीने से ज्यादा भी आप कैपिटलाइज करते हैं यहां तो आप किसी भी उसमें कर लेंगे तीसरा डिफरेंस आपने फंड बोरो किए 1 अगस्त को यूज करने शुरू किए 1 जनवरी से अकाउंट्स में आप इंटरेस्ट कैपिटलाइज करेंगे 1 जनवरी से
हमने तो यहां से पूरी बजट बोरोइंग से
और यहां पर इनकम टैक्स में आप डेटा बोरोइंग से करेंगे
यही डिफरेंसेस की वजह से हमें वो करना पड़ेगा
आईसीडीएस इसीलिए फॉर्म 3 सीडी में वो डिस्क्लोजर अलग-अलग स्टैंडर्ड वाइज डालना पड़ेगा आईसीडीएस 1 2 3 2
सबके अफेक्ट
4 5 6 7 8 9 10 सब का इफेक्ट It will take a lot of time, इसलिए fees भी charge
नहीं करता,
fees भी charge करनी चाहिए। हम chartered accountant
सर हमें इस साल fees का अगले साल मिलती है आप कह रहे हैं
हाँ तो अगले साल मिल जाएगी सर लेकिन charge करनी चाहिए।
But wait, what time takes place? I don't do audit, that's why I'm not aware. But then it means it is, there is a column in form 3C.
Yeah, there is a column in form 3C. अब इसमें क्या है इस period की जो interest income आई है पैसे को आपने temporary
20 सितंबर तक हो जाएगा
होगा सर वही करना तो पिछली बार भी था लेकिन पिछली बार लोगों ने दिल्ली हाई कोर्ट जजमेंट का फायदा उठा लिया चलिए ठीक है उठाना भी चाहिए तभी हम बार बार कह रहे हैं इसको हटवा दीजिए मुसीबत है
मैं फोन उठाने वाला आई विल रिकमेंड
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल इसको रिकमेंड कर
ओके
देन इसमें कोई जो टेम्परेरी इन्वेस्टमेंट से जो इनकम हुई उस पर टैक्स आपको अभी देना पड़ेगा जैसे मैंने पहले भी बताया था जब आईसीडीएस 2 की बात थी और यहाँ पे आपको अकाउंटेंसी में इंटरेस्ट एक्सपेंस से आप इसको रिड्यूस करेंगे अब एक जनरल बोरिंग का कॉन्सेप्ट है उसका मैं बता देता हूँ एएस 16 के अंदर हम उसमें वेटेड एवरेज कैपिटलाइजेशन रेट लगाते हैं सपोज आपकी आपकी 50 करोड़ की बोरिंग है 10 करोड़ की स्पेसिफिक बोरिंग थी और 40 करोड़ की जनरल पर्पस लोन है कुछ एसेट के लिए भी यूज कर रहे हैं कुछ इन्वेंट्री के लिए यूज कर रहे हैं कुछ वर्किंग कैपिटल के लिए
यूज करना है सपोज आई बोरोड फॉर सीसी लिमिट
नहीं 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 जनरल पर्पस कॉर्पोरेट लिमिट आपने उस केस में आप कैसे कैपिटलाइज करेंगे ए इंटू बी बाई सी देखिए अब इसमें भी फॉर्मूले आ गए सर
ये फॉर्मूले तो सब इनकम टैक्स में से हुए हैं इनकम टैक्स इशू
इनकम टैक्स में ही है ये फॉर्मूला अकाउंट्स में नहीं है
आजकल सभी सभी जगह फॉर्मूला लगा दिए
तो ए में आएगा बोरिंग कॉस्ट और बी में आएगा आपका एवरेज ऑफ क्वालिफाइंग एसेट ओपनिंग और क्लोजिंग का एवरेज ओपनिंग में है क्लोजिंग में नहीं है तो ओपनिंग और पुट टू यूज का एवरेज ओपनिंग में नहीं है क्लोजिंग में है तो क्लोजिंग का एवरेज क्लोजिंग का हाफ और सी आएगा आपका टोटल ऑफ ऑल एसेट्स एक्सक्लूडिंग Average of or total of all assets, opening closing divided by 2, excluding assets.
So something was 8D में भी था हमारे
तो उसका फिर आप average लेंगे. एक चीज और हम accountancy में interest capitalize करते हैं till the time the asset is available for use और income tax में till it is put to use. कभी-कभी सेम भी हो जाते हैं जनरली सेम हो सकते हैं पर डिफरेंस भी हो सकते
हैं
पुट टू यूज हमेशा बाद में आएगा अवेलेबल
तो लेकिन हमारे अकाउंटेंट इनकम टैक्स में पैसिव यूज को भी कई बार पुट टू यूज मान देते हैं इसी बात
अच्छा
सपोज आई हैव अ स्टैंडबाय इक्विपमेंट आई एम नॉट एबल टू यूज इट बट स्टिल इट इज पुट टू यूज व्हेनेवर आई नीड आई कैन टेक इट जनरेटर आजकल तो इलेक्ट्रिसिटी जाती कम हो गई पहले तो जाती थी बहुत यू कैन नॉट से दैट जनरेटर कैन नेवर बी यूज्ड बट
सर वो तो फाइनेंशियल स्टेटमेंट में भी जिस दिन आपने परचेस कर लिया स्टोर में ले आए वो अवेलेबल फॉर यूज है स्टैंडबाय इक्विपमेंट पे डेप्रिसिएशन चार्ज करना
होता है पुट टू यूज तब मानते जब वो स्टैंड पूरा तैयार होकर स्टैंड वो उसका फिक्स हो
हां वो उसमें भी है लास्ट आता हूं आईसीडीएस 10 पे प्रोविजंस कंटिजेंट लायबिलिटी एंड कंटिजेंट एसेट एक इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट है कि कंटिजेंट एसेट्स को भी आपको ऑफर करना पड़ेगा टैक्स के लिए इफ देयर इज अ रीजनेबल सर्टेनिटी ऑफ इट्स रिलायबिलिटी जबकि हम फाइनेंशियल स्टेटमेंट में वर्चुअल सर्टेनिटी का कॉन्सेप्ट लेके चलते हैं बट यहाँ रीजनेबल सर्टेनिटी विच इज अ मच लोअर थ्रेशोल्ड मे बी 50% और मोर जबकि वर्चुअल सर्टेनिटी तो 90-95% 98% पे आती है क्योंकि आपको जैसे ही वो हुआ तो आपको इनकम टैक्स आप उस पर दे दीजिए सो टू समराइज एक ही लाइन में सर ने समझा दिया कि प्रीपोन ऑल इनकम पोस्टपोन ऑल एक्सपेंसेस
सो एंड लॉसेस अनलेस इनकर्ड
यस एंड लॉसेस अनलेस दीज आर द की पॉइंट्स क्वेश्चन
That was a great understanding. So basically, ICDS is to bridge the gap between financial accounts and tax.